It could be something good that you covet after, but it may not be God's will for your life, and therefore that thing that is good is evil. I like what David said in the book of Psalms. He said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Why would I want anything else besides the Lord or what he has for me? He's my shepherd, I shall not want. In other words, David's saying, because I have the Lord, I'm not going to covet after anything. So you see something, you covet after of it, and then that affects you where you take it and you participate in that sin. And the next thing that happens is guilt sets in and you try to cover your sin. You try to hide it. The Bible says that when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. I don't care what kind of sin it is. Sin when it is conceived. All that is in my flesh, it is a desire to do everything that's anti-Bible, that's anti-God, that's anti-God's will. Kevin wants to do what Kevin wants to do. I don't want anybody telling me what to do. That's what my flesh says, yeah? And that's what all of our flesh says. We have a lust in our flesh to do that which is wrong. And the Bible tells us in the book of Galatians chapter number 5, list everything that the flesh wants. Idolatry, it goes on and on. There's a whole list there. And that's what my flesh wants. The problem is when the devil cannot make me sin. He does not have the power to make somebody sin. You know, you hear the saying, the devil made me do it. That's scary. The devil made me do it. Yeah, and that's not true. The devil cannot make you sin. He cannot force anybody to sin. But what the devil does is he tempts you. He tempts you to do wrong. He knows that your flesh wants to do evil. So what does he do? The Bible says that he is the god of this world. He's the prince and the power of the air. He is not the god of the mountains and the trees and the oceans, but he is the god of this world system. And what he does is he uses the world to appeal to our flesh. That's why people, they give in to peer pressure. The things of this world, he markets evil. He sells you his sin via television and what's going on in the world. And what happens is when his temptation meets your lust, sin is conceived, just like a baby. It's conceived. And the Bible says sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. I don't care what kind of sin it is. The wages of sin, the Bible says, is death. You take somebody who does drugs, you follow their life all the way down to the end of the road, you have death. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. You take somebody who is a murderer and you follow their life all the way down to the end of the road, you're going to have death. Obviously, they murdered people and the Bible says, he who lives by the sword shall die by the sword. You're going to have death. Why? The wages of sin is death. You take somebody who tells lies, you follow their life all the way down to the end of the road, you're going to have death. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. And that is exactly what the devil did. He deceived Eve. Eve believed Satan's lies, and she was deceived. She saw the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise. And then she took the fruit, and she gave it to Adam. Now, Adam chose Eve instead of choosing to obey God. He listened to her instead of listening to God. So Adam listen to Eve instead of God. That's your first blank there. L-I-S-T-E-N-E-D. He listened to Eve instead of God. Whenever you start listening to somebody else besides God, that's when you're headed for trouble. And then, number two, Adam willfully ate the fruit. He willfully ate the fruit. W-I-L-L-F-U-L-L-Y. He willfully ate the fruit. He knew it was wrong. His wife offered it to him, and he chose. He knew it was going to happen. He was specifically told by God himself what would happen if he ate that fruit. And so, now we see that the consequences that were deserved, D-E-S-E-R-V-E-D, deserved, the consequences that were deserved. Because you sin, there is a consequence for that sin. Oh yeah, you might be saved, but you still have to pay the consequences for your sins. You take somebody who is on death row, and they're in prison, and they killed somebody. They've been sentenced to death. They're sitting in jail. While they're in jail, somebody comes in, has a prison ministry, and they come into jail, and they lead this person to the Lord. Does that mean that they still don't have to face their sentence? Well, yeah, they still have to face their sentence, even though they got saved. They still have to pay for the consequences of their sin. Same in our life. When you sin, there is results to that sin. There is wages to that sin. And so God dished out his punishment on sin. I call it the curse of the belly. The serpent had to go on his belly. He said, "Thou art cursed above all the cattle of the field, and upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life." So the devil had to go on his belly. And then the woman, the Bible says that the woman multiplied in sorrow and conception in the belly. So it affected her belly. And then man had to till the ground. The ground was cursed, and he had to produce the fruit of it by the sweat of his brow, and all the fruit that he would produce to put in his belly, it would come from a cursed ground. So the serpent was cursed upon his belly, the woman was cursed in childbirth in her belly, and the man, the food that he put in his mouth that went into his belly, it was all cursed. That was the consequences of his sin. So Adam and Eve's eyes were open, and they saw they were naked. Naked is your blank there. Remember, death equals separation. Adam and Eve's eyes were open, and they saw they were naked. Naked here is much more than a lack of clothes. Adam and Eve realized that something had changed drastically before the image of God was clearly seen in them. Now it has been corrupted. Adam and Eve died spiritually. Adam and Eve died spiritually. Turn to the book of Ephesians, chapter number 2. Ephesians chapter number 2. Adam and Eve died spiritually. That's S-P-I-R-I-T-U-A-L-L-Y. Adam and Eve died spiritually. And then turn to Ephesians chapter number 2. Look what the Bible has to say there. It says, "And you hath he quickened." That word quickened means to make alive. "And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love, wherein he hath loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." So God, through his grace and his mercy, took us who were dead and quickened us, made us alive. But we were dead spiritually. We were dead spiritually. We didn't understand the things of God. We couldn't even comprehend the things of God. We didn't have a relationship with God because spiritually we were dead. But when you got saved, the Spirit of God came in you and made you alive and made you aware of spiritual things and made you restore that relationship with God. And so Adam and Eve died spiritually. And then Adam and Eve began to die physically. They began to die physically. If Eve would have never taken that fruit, we never would have gotten old. We never would have had to die physically. And they didn't die immediately. She didn't take a bite and drop over dead. But what had happened was the death started to work in her physically. And when Adam took of the fruit, death started to work in him physically. They started to die. The time clock started when they ate that fruit on the day that their death was going to come and visit them. They were going to die. By the way, the Bible says every man is appointed to die. We all have an appointment with death. And every day that appointment gets a little bit closer. Every second that appointment with death gets a little bit closer, because we're all appointed to die. We have a day on God's calendar where he says, you're going to die unless we're raptured out of here. This is the day you die. And why is that? It's because we sinned. Because Adam sinned, and that sin nature has been passed on to us. And so now we have a day of death that's marching towards us. And so Adam and Eve died spiritually. Adam and Eve began to die physically. Adam and Eve tried to hide from God. By the way, you can't hide from God. But that's exactly what they tried to do. They tried to cover themselves with fig leaves, and they went and hid among the trees. And God came walking in the cool of the day when he used to talk with Adam and Eve and used to commune with Adam and Eve. And he said, Adam, where art thou? Now, he wasn't asking that because he didn't know where Adam was. God's God. He knows everything. But he was asking that as a rhetorical question because he wanted Adam to know where Adam was. And so they hid themselves. Same thing happens when we sin. We try to hide it, just like Eve tried to hide, just like Achan tried to hide his sin and bury it in his tent, just like David tried to hide his sins by killing Uriah and trying to cover it up and sending him into the hottest point of battle and letting the Amalekites fall on him. We do the same thing when we sin. Guilt sets in. We know that we've done something wrong, and so we try to hide our sins. We lie. We try to cover it up. We try to hide it. We don't want anybody to know. We try to hide it from God, but you can't hide from God. The Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs that the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. He's watching. He's always watching. And then Adam and Eve were afraid of God. Afraid of God. That's your next blank there. So you should have spiritually, physically, P-H-Y-S-I-C-A-L-L-Y, hide and afraid. They were afraid of God. Why would somebody be afraid of God? Well, that's what sin causes. It causes you to be afraid of God. We're supposed to fear God. That means we're supposed to respect him. We're supposed to fear his judgment. We're supposed to, just like you fear your dad, just like if you were working, you fear your boss, because they have the authority over you, and so you respect them, and you have a certain level of fear. But to be afraid is something different. That's what sin makes you, afraid of God. Why would somebody be afraid of God? He's loving. He's kind. He's plenteous in mercy, the Bible said. He's ready to pardon. I mean, this is a God of love. The Bible tells us in the book of 1 John that God is love. Why would you be afraid of that? Well, because when you sin, there's a guilt that sets in you, and you fear God. And so most people end up running from God instead of running to God. Only God can fix your problems. That brings me to my next point. Adam tried to blame God. He tried to blame God. You say, well, wait a second, how did he blame God? Well, he said, the woman that thou hast given me gave me this fruit. In other words, if you wouldn't have gave me this woman, I would have never have sinned. And then he questioned Eve, and she said, she tried to blame God too. She said, the serpent that thou hast created beguiled me. So she said, if you would have never created this serpent, I would have never sinned. You can't pass the buck to somebody else. Ultimately, what you're doing is you are passing the buck to God, because he's the one that created everything. And you know, when you sin against God. And I guess this is kind of where the fear comes in too, because you know you've done wrong. You know, if I was to punch my brother in the face, he would probably turn around and punch me back. If I was to go up to my dad and punch him in the face, man, he would take off his belt. He told me one time, if you ever run from me, you might as well keep on running, because I'm going to get you and I'm going to tear you up. Don't ever run from me. You see, there's a different level of punishment there, because he has more authority than my brother. What if I was to go up to a police officer and just punch him square in the nose? Well, he'd probably throw handcuffs on me and put me in the back of a squad car and haul me off to jail, because the level of punishment, he's going to punish me more than my dad is, and he's definitely going to punish me more than my brother is, because the level of punishment is different and more severe as you move up in authority. Could you imagine I walk into the courtroom and I'm standing there and there's the judge and I make it past the bailiff and I just punch the judge right in the mouth, what would happen? Oh man, you don't want to know what would happen. You would be whatever charges were against you, you can plan on getting the maximum penalty for it. Because the judge has more authority than a police officer. A police officer has more authority than my dad. My dad has more authority than my brother. Could you imagine going up to God and punching him in the face? Man, what would happen? I mean, this is God who can send people to hell. David said this in the book of Psalms, chapter number 51. He said, "Against thee and against thee only have I sinned." When you sin, you're not just sinning against your brother. You're not sinning against your parents. You're not sinning against the police officer. You are sinning against God. He is the ultimate authority. And he has set up all the authorities in your life. And so when you break one of his authorities that he has set up in your life, you're ultimately sinning against him. And what excuse can you possibly have? The Bible tells us in the book of Romans, chapter number 1, that they are without excuse. You don't have an excuse to sin. So sin affected Adam and Eve that way. Sin affected Adam and Eve's relationship, not only with God, but to one another. It affected their relationship with one another. And the Bible tells us now that the wife would be subject to the leadership of her husband. Subject, S-U-B-J-E-C-T. The wife would be subject to the leadership of her husband. And that her desire shall be to rule over him. Her desire, D-E-S-I-R-E. It is our sin nature that leads us to relationship problems today. R-E-L-A-T-I-O-N-S-H-I-P. It is sin that leads to our relationship problems today. If you have a problem with somebody, or they have a problem with you, the root is sin. The root is sin. It's what divides us. It's what causes separation. It's what leads to all of our relationship problems today. So, the only hope for a good relationship is to deal honestly with our sin problem. The only hope for us for a good relationship is to deal honestly, H-O-N-E-S-T-L-Y, honestly, with our sin problem. So, not only did sin affect the relationship, man's relationship with God, not only did sin affect the relationship with each other, but sin also affected man's relationship with creation. The ground, the Bible says, became cursed. The ground became cursed. God made thorns and thistles to spring up. You know, it's interesting that thorns are a result of sin. And if you trace thorns throughout the Bible, they are always connected with sin. As a matter of fact, in the book of Matthew, chapter number 13, it talks about the seed and the sower. Remember, he planted the seed in the good ground, and it brought forth 100 fruit. But before that, he planted it in the stony ground. He planted it in the ground, and the thorns and the thistles came up. And then he tells us that the thorns and the thistles were the cares of this world and the sin of riches. And it's always connected to something bad because it was brought here from the curse because Adam and Eve sinned. It's interesting to me that when Jesus Christ, before he died on the cross, they brought him into a mock trial, and they put a crown of thorns upon his brow. That's interesting to me that he literally wore the crown that was the curse upon his head. That's what he wore. The Bible says, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God. He literally wore the curse on his head. And the Bible says that he sweat great drops of blood. And when God cursed the ground, he told Adam that by the sweat of thy brow, you're going to have to till the ground to get the food to put in your belly. So in original creation, there was no sweat. It wasn't until the curse came into this world and God cursed the ground that man began to sweat. I don't think Jesus Christ ever had to sweat because he never sinned. But the Bible says that he sweat, not sweat like normal people. The Bible says he sweat as if it were great drops of blood. And he sweat something different because he was taking on sin. He was becoming sin. He was taking on the curse that was placed on creation, the curse that was placed on man. And so then we see that compassion was shown. Compassion was shown. God promised them a deliverer. Deliverer. This is the first mention of a savior. It is sometimes called the proto-evangelium. That's proto, next word, evangelion. proto-evangelion. God made them coats of skin to cover their nakedness. Blood had to be shed. And God drove them from the garden and kept them from returning lest they eat of the tree of life and never die. This was an act of mercy by God. An act of mercy by God. Turn, if you would, please, to Genesis chapter number 3, verse number 15. Genesis chapter number 3, verse number 15. And here is the first mention, the proto-evangelium. It says in verse number 15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman. He's talking to the serpent here. He says, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. The seed. You know, the seed is what is in us to procreate and to produce children and stuff. We have seed. When a man and woman comes together, the seed and the egg come together, and a child is born. And he says, thy seed. Did you know that Satan has seed? Satan has seed. This is the Antichrist that he's talking about here. The Antichrist is literally the seed of Satan. And he's going to be Satan in the flesh, manifesting himself in the flesh during the tribulation. And then it says, her seed. This is, women don't have seed. But what it's talking about here is this is the virgin-born Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the seed of the woman. He is the virgin-born Savior. Notice it says it. It says, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. What is this it talking about? Well, it's connected to someone. We know that because it says, it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So the it is the same as the his. It's a person. And this it is the Lord Jesus Christ. In the book of Isaiah, chapter number 11, verse number 10, the Bible says, and in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious. So we know that this it there is something the Gentiles are going to seek. And then it says, and it's going to bring rest, his rest. So we know this it is a person. And then in the book of Luke, chapter number 2, verse number 16 and 17, the Bible says, and they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. So the it there is the child. The child is Jesus. So the it in these passages was Jesus. Now, the word it is made up of the letters I and the letter T. And the Bible tells us in the book of Matthew chapter number 5 that not one jot nor one tittle will pass away until all the law be fulfilled. Now, what is a jot? A jot is a little dot above an I. What is a tittle? A tittle is the crossing of a T. And so what he's saying there, the jot, the I, the tittle, the T, the it shall not pass away until all the law be fulfilled. What he was saying is that not one part of me shall pass away. I am the law. I am the word. I am the it. So the it here in Genesis chapter 3, verse number 15, is the Lord Jesus Christ. It is a prophecy that the Son of God, the it, the law, the word that was made flesh, is going to come into this world, and he is going to bruise the heel of Satan. He's going to crush the skull of the Antichrist. He is going to bruise his head and crush his skull. He is going to destroy Satan. You know, Satan had all the power in this world, and man could not stop him. We needed somebody who was more than a man to come and stop him. And that's why God gave us his mercy in sending us the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's our notes for today. I just want to do a quick review because tomorrow we're going to have a quiz. And so you may want to take some notes here. All right, number one, at the beginning of our notes, talking about creation, you want to know this, that God brought this world into existence for a purpose. God brought this world into existence for a purpose. God brought this world into existence for a purpose. Has everybody got it? Number two, God is a triune being. T-R-I-U-N-E. God is a triune being. God is a triune being. He exists as three persons. He exists as three persons. E-X-I-S-T-S. He exists as three persons. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He exists as three persons. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God is a triune being. He exists in as three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Number four. Man was created to be dependent upon God. Man was created, C-R-E-A-T-E-D, to be dependent, D-E-P-E-N-D-E-N-T, upon God. Man was created to be dependent upon God. Number five, God created man for fellowship. God created man for fellowship. F-E-L-L-O-W-S-H-I-P. God created man for fellowship. Number six. This is going to cover our lesson on the fall of man. Satan was the anointed cherub. Satan was the anointed cherub. A-N-O-I-N-T-E-D, anointed cherub. C-H-E-R-U-B. Satan was the anointed cherub. Satan was the anointed cherub. Okay, number eight. This is going to be a three-part answer here. So just write down these three things. How Satan, the challenge by Satan. The challenge by Satan. Challenge. This challenge by Satan. Number one, Satan corrupted God's word. Satan corrupted God's word. C-O-R-R-U-P-T-E-D. Satan corrupted God's word. Satan corrupted God's word. Number two, Satan changed God's word. Satan changed God's word. And number three, Satan challenged God's word. Satan challenged God's word. Challenged. Satan challenged God's word. Okay, now number nine is another three-part answer on what sin affected. What sin affected? A-F-F-E-C-T-E-D. What sin affected? Number one, it affected man's relationship with God. Sin affected man's relationship with God. R-E-L-A-T-I-O-N-S-H-I-P. Sin affected man's relationship with God. The next part of it is, sin affected Adam and Eve's relationship to one another. Sin affected Adam and Eve's relationship to one another. Sin affected Adam and Eve's relationship to one another. And then the last part of it is, sin affected man's relationship with creation, C-R-E-A-T-I-O-N. Sin affected man's relationship with creation. And the last one, number 10. Is that God promised them a deliverer. God promised them a deliverer. D-E-L-I-V-E-R-E-R. God promised them a deliverer. So it'll be a 10-question quiz, and then I'll have a bonus question on there for you. So you might want to look over your notes to see what the bonus question is going to be. But it should, I think everybody should make an A on it. It's not going to be a hard one. Yes, ma'am. Number eight. Number eight is the challenge by Satan. Satan corrupted God's word, Satan changed God's word, and Satan challenged God's word. You get that? It was a different one that you... What, are you still missing one? What, read to me what you got. Thank you. That's 10 questions, yeah? Oh, so you're not missing any. Huh? Oh, it was nine? Okay. Number one is he brought this world into existence for a purpose. Number two is God is a true triune being. Number three, he exists as three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Number four, man was created to be dependent upon God. Number five, God created man for fellowship. Number six, the Satan was the anointed cherub. Oh. I left out number seven, that's right. Hey, good eye. Okay, so we'll just have nine questions. Or let me give you another one. Okay, here's one. This will be number 10. Let me write this down. Sorry about that. And I'll tell you what, the bonus is. The first mention of a savior in the Bible is called the Protoevangelion. Protoevangelion. That's the first mention of a savior in the Bible. And here's your bonus, if you can get it. The bonus is always going to be a Bible verse. So if you can quote this Bible verse, write it down. It'll be a bonus point on your quiz. The verse is Genesis 3:15. Genesis 3:15. And I'm not going to count off for spelling or anything or punctuation, but just make sure you got all the words in there, yeah? All right, I was going to play a video. Yeah, I have enough time.